So let us start by moving to the next section that will talk about psychology and its relation to health. So when we say the word health, it encompasses a huge domain where we are not only talking about the physical health but also mental well-being. So mental well-being and physical health is together known as the concept of health, and psychology is the science of behavior. And it has much to contribute to enhance health promotion, disease prevention, address health disparities. And also we have to keep in mind that psychological well-being is basically about a person's life going on well. So he has to understand the concept of feeling good and functioning effectively. Only then you can say that a person is healthy when he is healthy in the real sense of the term, both mentally as well as physically. Sometimes there might be certain physical illnesses, but a person may be feeling good and might still contribute to the social functioning in a proper way. Then the person is considered to be healthy. Therefore, psychological well-being is about an individual's perception of happiness, well-supported and satisfied life. And that is known as the concept of health. And therefore, we see that there is a close relation between psychology and the concept of health. And in psychology and pro-social behavior, the word pro-social behavior implies that kind of behavior which is beneficial for the society. Pro-social behavior is social responsibility, which is an implicit duty of every individual or an act to behave towards others for the benefit of the society. That means your behavior as an individual belonging to the society is more acceptable. And that acceptable behavior is known as pro-social behavior. So pro-social behavior describes a person's behavior, helping behavior towards others without any obligations or self-interest. It shows a lot about your personality, how giving you are, and how humane you are. Humane in the sense being more pro towards the behavior towards the society. It is the analysis of human orientation towards others. How you treat others, what is your behavior in the society, it is known as the pro-social behavior. Social work as a profession, as it is known as a noble profession, it helps to attain pro-social behavior of any individual and deals with social deviance with empathy. Now, coming to the concept of social deviance, what is social deviance? That kind of behavior which is not socially accepted or which might be harmful for another individual in the society, a person's behavior harming another individual in the society is known as social deviant behavior. And to deal with such deviant behavior or social deviance is one of the objectives of social work profession. And to understand social pro-social behavior as well as understand the concept of social deviance, the role of psychology is immense here. Therefore, a social work professional has to have the psychological understanding of these two terms, that is pro-social behavior and social deviance. Now, what is empathy? Empathy is a principle of social work, again, is a feeling which enables you or is a skill that enables you as a social worker to understand the problem of the client from his perspective. That means, as we say, understanding the problem of another person while standing in another's shoes. That means understanding the problem from his or her perspective and not unconsciously or consciously putting over our prejudices over the person. That is known as empathy, the ability to understand an individual and to share others' feelings is highly linked with pro-social behavior. Therefore, empathy is said to be an ability of an individual to understand the problem of the other from the perspective of the other and not from your perspective. The degree of pro-social behavior varies from person to person. Social influence and social cognition. Influence. The influence that occurs when one's emotions, opinions, and behaviors are affected by others. That means, as you see, the two terms, social influence, that means the influence on an individual that is given by another person or another one in the society. It occurs when one's emotions, opinions, and behaviors are highly affected by what others are doing, by how others are treating you, or how others are behaving. It automatically impacts your social behavior. That is known as social influence. It takes many forms and can be seen in conformity, in socialization, in peer pressure, obedience, leadership, and persuasion. So all these things are influenced by the other in the society. It is a well-known fact that more people in a group, more will be the power of influence of that particular group. Yes, because we try to influence each other when we are in a social group. According to the social cognitive theory, an individual's behavior is not directly influenced by any external stimuli, but those which we allow us to affect us. Therefore, cognitive theory says that an individual's behavior is not directly influenced by any external stimuli, like any random thing, but those things which you allow us to affect us. The capacity of information processing in mind is also a factor in social cognition. Cognition which helps gradually, which develops gradually from childhood to adolescence. Cognition is the ability to understand the social behavior. That is why it is known as social cognition. Belonging to a society, an individual develops the understanding the behavior of another individual or groups or members in the group. That ability to bring about that understanding is known as social cognition. Now moving on to this branch of psychology, which is known as developmental psychology. Human beings undergo changes pertaining to physical, mental, social, emotional, spiritual as they advance through their life cycle. And developmental psychology, as the word itself says, as a human being develops from being a fetus in the mother's womb to being delivered as an infant, then childhood, then adolescence, and then adulthood, and then old age, a person develops mentally. Apart from physically, the mind also develops, and the outlook develops, the emotional, psychological, spiritual, all the aspects develop. That is why it is known as developmental psychology. The psychology that deals with the development stages of any individual, any human being, is known as developmental psychology. It studies the physical, social, psychological changes that occur at different ages, stages over the lifespan of a human being, from conception to old age. Developmental psychology will help you to understand why certain changes in behavior take place from a person's childhood to old age. So there are so many transition stages, and these are the stages that has been put forth. And the prenatal stages, it refers to the formation of the fetus in the mother's womb, and here major body parts are formed inside the mother's womb, and then after that the brain starts to develop. And neonatal stage, that is 3 to 4 weeks after the birth of the baby, when the birth takes place, the child, infant, tries to adjust with the social environment, with the outside world. So neonatal deals with those crucial 3 to 4 weeks after the birth of the baby, when the baby is said to be struggling to adjust with the outside environment, the air, the environment, or the social situation. So the baby is trying to adjust to that particular needs, the basic needs of food, air, water, and also love that the person will feel, that the child will feel. It comes in, though it is in the unconscious or semi-conscious state of mind. Then infancy, the period when the baby actively tries to interact with the outside world with the help of certain bodily and verbal cues. Here the baby is more active, and you will see a lot of behavioral changes in the particular infant. Childhood is that phase where a child develops skills and abilities and a personal identity is formed. Therefore, the child is more active, he or she develops certain skills, and there is a personality that is being formed in the particular child. In adolescence, this is a huge transition stage where a person is usually in the confused state of mind whether the individual belongs to the childhood stage or he is supposed to be treated as an adult. So this is a transition stage. In this period, a system of values, interests develop in an individual which prepare the ground for taking responsibilities for an adult life. It creates a lot of confusion in the mind of an adolescent, and also he or she wants to explore new things in life, as this is an important stage of transition. The adulthood stage, when an individual enters the adult society, it acquires an occupation and has his own family, and therefore responsibilities come in. And here we see that the person struggles sometimes in adjustmental issues. So in each of these stages, you will see that there are usually adjustmental problems that an individual goes through. So moving from the adulthood stage, where the adult individual enters into a society and takes up responsibility of his family and occupation, then moving to the senescent stage, and also that comes also can be termed as old age stage, where an individual crosses around 70 years of age, and then he is considered to be a person who has had all the life experiences and is knowledgeable and conscious about the various realities of life. This is also the stage where a person may suffer the grief of the loss of a spouse and also has many adjustmental issues when the person suddenly becomes, you know, when the person loses economic independence, or where the person, if not much dependent on his own savings, will have to depend on the earnings of their children, and therefore it brings about a lot of life crisis or a crisis situation in the mental setup. So this stage also deals with a lot of loneliness and also, you know, adjustmental issues with the, maybe the person is living with a family of the previous, of the next generation, or maybe the person is living alone. Therefore, there will be a lot of adjustmental issues in this particular stage. The person also has to realize, when suppose a person at this stage of old age or senescence is going through certain kind of physical illnesses or mental illnesses, the person has to accept the reality of life, the reality of death, and therefore it might lead to a certain crisis situation, or, you know, or sometimes many go into the panic stage. Therefore, there is a lot of counseling that is required, or a social worker has to take the role of counseling and then, you know, making things clear to the particular people who are supposed in the confused state of mind. So therefore, in all this, in developmental psychology, as you see, which deals with these different stages of development, you'll see that the role of a social worker has a lot to do with, you know, sometimes that a parent may bring a child to a social worker who has, suppose, any problem in adjusting with the school environment or the family environment, or an adolescent who is under peer pressure or who might be under addiction. Then an adult person who might have certain life crisis or midlife crisis, and also has problem in his occupation or in the family, or may have problem with the spouse, and in old age may have problem with, you know, the sudden demise of a spouse, or the losing of economic independence, and that kind of many, and also onset of many illnesses. So all these things, all these different stages, a social worker has to play an important role when a client comes to the social worker seeking help in dealing with the adjustmental problems of these different stages. So in this class, we have discussed about the role of psychology on social work profession. We have understood that why these psychological concepts, understanding them is important for a social worker, because only by understanding these social concepts, the psychological concepts, you will be able to apply the methods of social work, specifically case work that deals with the individual problems, adjustmental problems. And another method is group work. Again, in social psychology, we are dealing with the individual's behavior in a group setting, in a societal setting. Therefore, practicing group work and case work, you need to have the basic foundation or basic understanding of psychological concepts. Pro-social behavior, how a person behaves for the benefit of the society, which is not harmful for the society. And the behavior that is harmful for the society is known as social deviance. Social influence and cognition is that how the society influences the behavior of the individual, and the social understanding that an individual has is known as social cognition. And developmental psychology deals with the different adjustmental problems in the developmental stages of any human being, starting from the prenatal, postnatal, infancy, childhood, adolescence, adulthood, and then old age or senescence. So that is all. I hope this video has been helpful to you in bringing about an understanding the different psychological concepts and why psychology as a discipline is important in social work profession. Thank you. So these are some of the references that are set here. Also, our ESLM section and the ones that are given in the LMS, you will be seeing that there are the different self-learning materials on this particular course, on the various courses that we have introduced in the Bachelor of Social Work program. Thank you so much.